Good afternoon, everyone. We are over the moon with excitement and honored to have with us today a preeminent voice in historical romance fiction, Eloisa James. Ms. James is the author of 24 novels, 22 of which have become bestsellers. Her latest, 7 Minutes in Heaven, recently debuted at number 6 on the New York Times bestseller list and at number 10 on the USA Today bestseller list. She was also awarded the romance industry's top award in 2013 for her novel, Seduced by a Pirate. When she isn't penning Regency and Georgian tales, Ms. James has a day job as a professor of English literature, specializing in Shakespeare at Fordham University in New York City. Thanks to the generous support of the Friends of the Allen County Public Library, she is here today to talk about why the romance genre is worthy of respect and definitely worth reading. Without further ado, Eloisa James.
Hey guys. Hello, thank you very much for coming. I'm just gonna fiddle with my phone for a second so I know when to quit. Hold on. This is always a problem with professors, you know, they put a big clock up and the students start moving towards the door if you go too late. But here, you guys are probably too polite, so I'll just put this thing on. Timer. Right. Stopwatch. Okay. Alrighty. So, they've asked me to come and talk to you about why romance novels deserve respect. So I'm going to hope that all of you don't really need to hear about that. You really kind of just want to hear about where romance fits into culture, because I'll give you my one-line answer to that I just gave to Paula Poundstone on NPR. Every kind of writing deserves respect depending on how good the writer is. Frankly, there's the same percentage of people write romance very well that write literature very well, and those books deserve respect, period. End of story. So moving right along. I'm just going to tell you a little about me and how I got where I am. I grew up in a house that was full of classics. My father, Robert Bly, won the American Book Award for poetry. And my mother, Carol Bly, was a novelist. And our entire life was fashioned around literature. We had no television. We also had no white sugar. We had no, you know, sugar cereal, which I was addicted to, of course, to this day now. What we had was books, tons and tons of books. So the census man came to our house and he said, how many TVs do you have? My mother said, zero. He said, how many books do you have? She said, around 50,000. He wrote down 5 books, you know, 5 TVs, 50 books. Because that wasn't going to work for the U.S. Census. Like, our household didn't exist as far as he was concerned. But what it meant was, like, I remember, you know, probably being 7 and 8 years old, my father stopping in the door of my sister's in my bedroom because he would read to us every night Beowulf. Does anyone know Beowulf? It's, you know, Anglo-Saxon, very violent epics. And he would shout and scream. He would act out the parts, you know, or the Grendel, the great monster, you know. He would act them all out. And we learned really fast what literature was about, right? It's very violent. Very violent, very loud, very exciting. My mother, on the other hand, she loves Charlotte's Web. So one of my earliest memories is she's sitting on the couch reading us Charlotte's Web and weeping hysterically. And I was, you know, you learn, right? Okay, it's about violence. It's also about death. It's about death and maybe friendship in the middle. Some love, but death and violence. So I always thought I would never be like this. And if you have children, you know that what you think you'll never be like is exactly where you're going to end up. So I have this memory. My daughter has kidney disease, and she's fine. But when she was little, she was in the hospital a lot. And I have a memory of sitting on the hospital bed reading her Charlotte's Web for the second time and crying hysterically. And the nurse stopping in and saying, you know, she's really fine. I was like, and Anna looked up, and she's like, it's just Charlotte's Web. She always cries. I thought, oh, turned into my mom, right? But my dad used to recite anti-war poetry at the table. He was writing poetry for the Vietnam War. My mother really loved sort of lugubrious Russian novelists. So one of the last questions, and a question she asked me a lot, is why not try to be Tolstoy? You know, it's a complicated answer. I have no interest in writing Russian novels. Yeah, that wasn't going to cut it, because what she was asking was a deeper question, right? Why don't you try to write literature? Why don't you try to write the stuff that I've spent my entire life studying and writing and that I care most passionately about? To give you an example of this, my mother got ovarian cancer and decided not to have chemo, which, as you probably know, is largely ineffective with ovarian cancer anyway. And she said to the surgeon, "You have to give me enough time so I can get my novel into proofs." And then the surgeon was in there for 6-7 hours and came out and said, "I think she's got enough time." And sure enough, she had the proofs in the hospice. She got them done. And for her, from her point of view, that was a life perfectly spent. She said, "I'm having a great death. I got my proofs in. I have this wonderful drugs," which they did give her some amazing drugs. She was completely high, like, for the last week. But she felt that Turgenev was more ethical. So that's something I've had to struggle with, right? Is there something unethical about writing in a genre that's not literature, that's not Turgenev, that's not Tolstoy? It was very hard for my parents. My own reading taste was decidedly Philistine. I mean, I just liked romance. I was born that way. I swear I was born that way. It's like I decided I was going to raise my son without violence, and the first thing he did was like chew guns out of pieces of bread so he could shoot people. There's some things you're born with. And mine was romance. So I liked Jane Austen, but I also liked Harlequins. I liked the Barbara Cartlands that my mother had, that my grandmother had. I liked my mother's Jane Austens from Wellesley that she'd written like crabbed little notes in there, like, "This is ridiculous," you know, because she was an early strident feminist. My only requirement was passion. I wanted lots of passion. If it led to death, like Anna Karenina, you know, I could go with it, but I would prefer that didn't happen. One summer I went to camp and about 4 weeks in, I was there for 8 weeks. I wrote her these. I was just like, "You have to bring me some books. You know what? This is awful. There are no books in this place," because it was my first experience of camp, and I hadn't really taken in the idea of a place that didn't have books, right? That just had nothing, like just cabins and hardly any showers. So she brought me Anna Karenina. I read it 3 times, and she brought me the history of the Romanov court. You know how they all die. And they die in a bad way. Yeah, that was my reading. And she was, you know, she wanted me to become the person who was going to write that novel. My father was more into, say, Walt Whitman. And he laid down the law. He said, you know, for every romance you read, you're going to have to read a classic. Because it was one thing to isolate me off at camp and only give me, you know, Anna Karenina to read at home. They knew that my grandmother's Barbara Cartlands were really available. And the public library, which is one reason why I love coming to public libraries, had all of Georgette Heyer. And I love Georgette Heyer. I mean, she's the reason why I'm writing Regency and historical romance, probably. I read them over and over again. So here's the thing, is that Kathleen Woodiwiss and Barbara Cartland had written a lot of books, a lot. So I'm probably, and I will say almost definitively, the only person here who's read every single thing that Mark Twain has written. Raise your hand if you want to beat me. No. So you can see how my life starts bifurcating, right? It's like, oh, I'm setting myself up to be a Shakespearean, which I am. I'm a Shakespeare professor, right? I've published books about Shakespeare and about literature. I teach Shakespeare day in, day out. I teach drama to 1640. So I teach medieval plays. I teach, whatever needs to be taught, Dante. But at the same time, I was doing it in order to get to this other place. One place where it came together was I used to write romances. I had six children in the household at that point, and I would write plays, and I was the oldest. So everyone had to act in them, right? It was a requirement. My mother said, "You have to have a part for everyone." So I have a brother who's 10 years younger, so he would play the train track, or sometimes the train. But sometimes Cupid, because he was in diapers for a long time, which is very useful, Cupid, because my sister would only be a princess. And she was next oldest to me, so she always got her way, which meant I started writing romances and I started charging for them. So my dad at this point is a pretty famous poet. So this is, you know, the 70s. People are hitchhiking across country to the farm that I grew up in Minnesota, and these young poets would show up, and they just would, like, sit there. You know, they wanted to just sit at the feet of the master or whatever. And my father would put them in the cleaned-out chicken coop out in there and make them do chores like cleaning out the farm, but then, you know, cleaning out the barn. We had horses, we had cows, we had sheep, tons of chickens. And then I would take all the money that they had left after hitchhiking by plays. And depending on how many nights they stood, I had a large repertoire, so I could put on plays every night until I got all their money. So I also think it's really interesting. You can see your life sort of shaping up in this interesting way. If you look back at what you were doing very early, you might be able to see where you are now. Anyway, as a Fordham professor, so I'm Professor Bly, right? I have a bookshelf that's full of books written by white men. That's what I teach, right? As a New York Times bestselling Eloisa James, I have a bookshelf written by women. And I have a lot of romance, because you probably know if you read romance, it is the most feminist genre, right? It's written by women for women. It's about 46% of the market share of every book sold in America, so it is a tremendously powerful financial powerhouse that is the sturdy bottom to a lot of the literature publication. You know, when everything crashed and, say, HarperCollins was the poetry part of my publishing house, they kind of had to fire everyone on the Collins side, romance never went into the red, right? We stayed in the black. Because when people are stressed, they turn for escape. They may stop reading poetry, right? They may not be able to afford my dad's books, but they'll still find $5.99 in Sam's Club to buy a romance. It's sort of a stable corner of the publishing industry. Now, my two worlds don't really come together all that much, but because of my situation, they tend to more often. Like, you guys are here to hear both people in a way, right? Both my sides. I used to keep it very secret. Like, I had some great pink tweed suits that I would wear when I was Eloisa, and I'd put on my contacts. And then Mary would wear like pantsuits and glasses. And then I had something happen. It was in New York, and the Romance Writers of America had come to New York. And so there were like thousands of romance writers everywhere. It's one of the biggest professional organizations in the world, really, or it's certainly in America. And or certainly in publishing, I'd just say. I don't know about engineers, for example. There's probably a lot of them. But at the same week, the week afterwards, came the Shakespeare Association. And they have often team tagged each other. I've gone to the romance writers in New Orleans and then the Shakespeare Association the next, you know, the very next week. And somebody's like, how do you know all these good restaurants? You're like, oh, I just like New Orleans. This one, I had addressed the Librarians of America, which is huge. There's librarians here. You know how big it is. It was in New York. There were like tons of people, and I had given their address. And so I'm walking with my best friend, who's a Shakespeare professor at Columbia. We're walking down the street, and there's a big glass panel, and there's a huge restaurant in there. And all of a sudden, all the people are in the front door going like this. And she's like, Mary, it's kind of weird. All those people are pointing at you. I think they're pointing at you. They're not pointing at me. I was like, who knows? They probably made a mistake. I just walk on, and I thought, you know, this is not good, right? At this point, I kept it secret. It had to be secret because I wanted to get tenure. And when I made People Magazine's Page Turner of the Week, they wanted to have a picture of my face, and I went into the chair of my department. I said, you know, they'll give me more space on the book page. If you notice, it's divided into halves and thirds. They'll give me a half because I was getting Page Turner of the Week if I give them my picture. And he said, you will not get tenure. Please, you will not get tenure. And so the bifurcation continued for quite a while after that. But when this thing happened, by then I was coming up on tenure. I was pretty sure I was going to get it. So I got tenure, and then I told everyone in my department. And it was actually kind of an interesting scene because we went through all the business of the, you know, and then how, you know how in a committee meeting they always have other business at the end? And the other business is always like, you know, we're doing a bake sale, and if you could please bring some pumpkin muffins that are gluten-free. It was like, well, Mary has something to say. And at this point, the secretary put up eloisajames.com. So if you've looked at eloisajames.com, it's a huge freaking website, right? It's got all these parts. It's got Georgian paper dolls. It's got interactive parts. It's got all this stuff. And they were just staring at it. And I got a box of books, mixed books, and started handing them out. And they're like, what? Because to them, I am Shakespeare, right? And I was running the graduate program at that point. I thought that was really important, was to make sure that my colleagues understood that I wasn't going to say, oh, I have this other career, now I won't do any of the work. Because professors really run a university, right? It's all free labor, committees, etc. So I had to prove that. They just started trading them based on the covers. You know, like, no, I really like green dresses. No, there were a couple guys in the back who wouldn't take any, but they all retired pretty fast, luckily for me. But occasionally those things overlap. I'm going to tell you another story. The National Book Festival is on the Mall. Has anyone been to it? It's a very august situation. They have a cocktail party the night before in the National Library, you know, with the cupola and everything, and it's really intense. And they, you know, you kind of count how many Nobel Prize winners in literature are going to be there, and they decide they need a romance representative. So I'm going to be that representative because they can count on me to speak in full sentences. I really got that impression from them because they know very, very little. People know very little about romance. If I say, well, I went to Harvard, and guess what? There's enough of us New York Times bestsellers in Harvard to be one half of a basketball team. But Yale doesn't have any. They just look at me like, we're like, we could do Wellesley, though. Lisa Kleypas, she's a good forward, you know? We could do it. Anyway, they decide they want, and they sent me the list, right? So I am following Mario Vargas Llosa. Anyone know who he is? Nobel Prize winner in literature. He won it. The Swedish Academy, here's his description, trenchant images of the individual's resistance, revolt, and defeat. Now, in case you're wondering, none of my novels have any of that, right? There is no trenchant images, no revolt, no defeat for sure. I felt totally outclassed, right? I was like, okay, this is my mother's nightmare right here. I'm going to get up there and embarrass her in front of the people I was, it's all intense on the Mall. So I was convinced they would all try to come see, you know, Vargas Llosa. They want to be there. And then they would have to sit through Eloisa James to get there. So I spent the last few weeks like desperately worrying about it. And I kept thinking about this thing that comes from George Bernard Shaw when he talks about trash of the lowest melodramatic order. That's kind of what I write. I like melodrama a lot. And I've become, over the years, kind of inured to the idea of trash, too. Trash covers a lot of things. I'm a serious recycler. I think what's one person's trash is another one's gold. So I'm sticking with that. He also says, though, that, you know, he was talking about intellectually vulgar, foolish, offensive, indecent, and exasperating prose. And I just kept thinking, okay, this is what everyone's going to think, right? He was writing about that abominably written trash in 1896, because if you think about it, people have been fighting what they consider trash for a very long time. So what happened is I got there, and it was really lovely, because there were a lot of people who read romance who were surprised to even hear that the National Book Festival existed. But they lived in the Washington area, so they came and filled the tent. And then they said, how many of you have ever been to the book festival before? None of them. Right? They said, how many of you are coming for the first time? They all raised their hand, because guess what? Americans read a tremendous amount, and we read in very varied genres. We read all kinds of things. And that was the moment the book librarian at that point, the head of the National Book Festival, said, whoa, I didn't realize this. We just dropped out a lot of our citizens, right? We pretended they didn't exist while we were celebrating and flying over, you know, Nobel Prize winners from wherever they were being flown from. These people didn't even know we existed. So that was very helpful. But in the end, what came down to, I was doing CNN, and they said, well, don't you just write porn for women? Because you can be called trash, or you can have this implication come in that you're just writing about sex, right? That sex somehow is a bad thing to be writing about, that if your characters are having sex, they should be having it in the context of trenchant images of defeat, or they should go under the train tracks like Anna, you know, boom, and you're out. But the fact is, I like being paid for what I write, and romance is something where it doesn't stop at the bedroom door. So you end up being stuck with, not stuck with, but you're living and dying on strong emotion. And strong emotion includes sex, whether people want to ignore it or not. And the moral side of that, where the woman who expresses sexual desire goes under the wheels of a train, is not something that really suits our culture at the moment any longer. Tolstoy's gone, dead a long time. And I actually think it's kind of unethical in itself. I have nothing, you know, I have no problem with tragedies, although I have to say I'm sick of girls. Girls on trains, girls being killed, girls being serial killed, girls being scalped, girls being molested. I think we've gone a little far on that one. But romance responds to strong emotion. And so people often say, well, it's just about sex or it's just about trash. But the fact is, it isn't. If you don't ground a romance in what's really happening in your own life, in reality, it's like any other piece of work. It's going to die on the vine. So I'm sure everyone here has read a bad romance, right? In a bad romance, you go to your 20-year high school reunion, and you happen to be in fabulous shape. It's amazing what shape you're in. And he happens to be a Marine who also became a millionaire and just didn't have time to meet, you know, the woman of his dreams. Fabulous shape. And you have sex, like, in the back room, and then before you know it, you're married. It's boring. Romance can be incredibly boring if it doesn't have any grounding in reality. So one of the things I learned very early is that every single romance has got to have part of myself in it. You know, every single heroine has got to have a distinct part of myself, something really true. And I'll give you an example. In my second book, Midnight Pleasures, I was very worried that I was going to give birth prematurely. I had been in premature labor with my first child. I was terrified of it. So fine, I put it in the book, right? I poured it all into that book. My heroine lost her baby right around 24, 25 weeks. I had all the details wrong. This baby was pure white. It got wrapped in a cashmere scarf. My hero behaved perfectly, of course. If you know anything about micropremies, they're hairy. They're dark red. They're on a respirator. My baby was born exactly the same time as my heroines, about three months after I turned it in, right? So I was actually pregnant when I turned that book in, though I didn't know it at the time because she was born at 24 weeks. But I poured my fear into that book. And it has become something of a cult classic. It sells at a very high rate, even though I wrote it back in 1999, 2000, because it keeps getting picked up by lost mama groups, as they're called. And they write me letters, and they say, I don't know how you did it. You must have lost a child. You understood exactly what I felt. And I didn't understand it. All I could do was take the fragment of the fear that I had in my life that it would happen and just put that in the book. But when people are talking about romance and they're sort of summing it up as something like porn for women, they don't understand that good romance has got to tie down to our biggest fears, right? Our biggest fears, our biggest successes, our biggest emotions. It's not constantly about sex. So what it does is bring you into someone else's life. You escape your own life. That is not necessarily a bad thing. I'm going to read you a couple letters in the space of this, so I'm going to read you this one. My dear Eloisa, I live in Pakistan. You might have heard of it. Yeah. We're known for a host of screwed up, messed up things on the global media, including the Taliban and human rights violations. Living in this country, which can be so dark, but also so, so resilient and beautiful and gorgeous, full of art and culture, and I'd argue the world's most beautiful poetry, your books saved my life so many times. I was 15 when I started reading your novels. I was a voracious reader from a very, very poor family living in a two-room apartment with five other people. Being introduced to your novels helped me breathe, reminded me there were other and more beautiful things in life, showed me that we must all rise to our challenges and live our dreams, no matter what it takes. If you're looking at trenchant images of defeat, the thing about literature is it can change a whole country, right? It can change the way we think about defeat. If you think of Uncle Tom's Cabin, that Uncle Tom's Cabin had a profound effect, I mean, really a profound effect on what this country thought about slavery. If you look at Catch-22, which is about World War II, which is, you know, a just war, right? It still changed the way we thought about old men sending young men into war as basically cannon fodder. My books are not going to do that. You know, they're never going to change the way we think about slavery. But they might change one life, right? They might change the one life of someone living in a two-room apartment with five siblings, and you don't have to be in Pakistan for those letters to come to me. I get them all the time, right? I get all the time. My sister was dying in the hospice. She laughed because of your book, and I just wanted to let you know. She didn't finish it. I read it at her grave. These are letters that, you know, can rip you apart. They're not going to get you the Nobel Prize. And I would say when it comes to respect, the respect of being able to create something that takes somebody out of their life should be respected as much as something that changes all of our lives. It's a very different kind of option in a way. It's a different kind of goal, let's say. But it's equally important. So let's just go back for a second to that question of sex, of melodramatic trash, vulgar trash. George Bernard Shaw was writing about a romance, by the way. It was Shakespeare's Cymbeline. There's the Bodleian Library in Oxford. He was the first major librarian to get Bodley, Sir Thomas Bodley, wanted a copy of every book published in England. So he donated the money for the library, he got people to give money, and then we have these wonderful letters that go to his librarian when he says, you know, I can't believe this, I heard that you're collecting plays. You have to get rid of those right away because everyone will think that we are just a trash library. This meant, and the librarian did, which meant that the Bodleian Library had to pay millions of dollars to buy the Shakespeare folios they had thrown out, right? The quartos that they had thrown out, which are now like $5 million a piece. I'm not saying that romance novels are anywhere near Shakespeare. I mean, I teach Shakespeare day in, day out. For me, there is enormous difference between literature and genre fiction, right? But I am saying that we often make mistakes when we're deciding what is good. We do it even with our friends, right? We say, oh, that, you're not going to like that. That's terrible. Well, that may be the book that person wants. So I guess where I'd end is just by saying, let's look at these things more widely. I want to go back for a second to the question of sex. I had a dinner guest come who was a professor. You know, my husband and I are both professors, so we have a lot of dinner guests come over. This was before 50 Shades of Grey came out. And she turned to her daughter and she said, look, honey, you can write down all your dirtiest fantasies and make $1 million. You know, I have to say, when 50 Shades came out, I was like, you know, $1 million is like nothing, right? You could be making $17 trillion. But the thing that she didn't understand is that sex is a very relative, it's very relative to the cultural moment. So if you think about Keats wrote this letter about shagging. Do you have any idea what Keats might have been talking about? I mean, he's talking about sex, right? But what is involved in Keats shagging someone? We can't, right? We can't. It's one thing that we really can't access very well is what sex was like at any given moment. So the books that are called bodice rippers for a long time were called bodice rippers. It was because, you know, the woman would have her bodice ripped open, the buttons would go everywhere, and then she would be ravished and she enjoyed it enormously. This is the 70s and the 80s. And so, like, the New York Times asked me, can you write an op-ed and say why we should never use this term anymore? Well, the fact is that that is a historically accurate term for the 70s and 80s. And what a lot of sociologists have said, if you look at the 70s and 80s, you have the coming out of the pill, right? So all of a sudden, there's this enormous pressure, right? You have to make choices. You have to choose to have sex in ways that you might not be comfortable with, but in order to be cool, culture is telling you this and that. You can all think of this same stuff happening now to lots of young women and young men as well. The bodice ripping books allowed someone, it says introducing bedtime. I obviously hit the wrong thing here. Okay, we'll turn it off. We're not in a place where we can understand what the bodice ripper is at that point. I still write bodice rippers in a way. For mines, it's more like usually the woman is ripping open the guy's jacket and the buttons are going, because that's sort of where we are with sex now, right? We're in depictions of sex. It has to respond to what people want at the moment. That said, it can be the most difficult part of a book to write. And people are always asking me about it, so I'm just going to head off that question right now. There's a wonderful poem by Andrew Marvel called To His Coy Mistress. You guys know it? He says he would be happy to praise her breast for 200 years. He says 100 years would go to praise thy breasts and on thy forehead gaze, 200 to adore each breast, 30,000 to the rest. As the author of, you know, 24 books, I can tell you, sometimes I feel like I've spent 100 years on each breast. Like, 30,000 for the rest, let's not even get into that, right? They're, my heroes kind of like, they have equipment the size of the Hubble telescope. And they, we don't have to get into measurements because I never get into measurements, right? I try to avoid naming body parts. So you just have to kind of vaguely allow the reader to understand that the Hubble telescope just entered the room. And there's a lot of awe and respect. But the thing is, those books, out of a book, those scenes are quite small, and yet my colleagues consistently refer to them. I pass those books out all over. I don't think any of my colleagues ever read them. It's just not in their bailiwick, right? A book that looks like that is not something they're going to read, because a romance book has a very specific cover. A romance book promises that there'll be a happy ending. And so over time, the publishers have come up with a list of sort of things that go on the cover that promise that you'll be reading a romance. So one of them, for example, is foil, gold foil. Like the title might actually shine a little bit. That's a special, expensive kind of title. You're going to have a guy on the cover, maybe with a shirt, maybe without, right? Or you're going to have a girl on the cover in a historic outfit. Mine in 7 Minutes in Heaven. If you look at that book afterwards, it's very different from other romance covers because she's looking straight at you and she has a little smile. That's because I rejected 7 versions of a cover in which a girl was splayed on a bed. And I kept saying, my heroine in this book owns her own governess agency. She is an entrepreneur in the period. I came to this because where a lot of my undergraduates are graduating and starting businesses, what they're doing is actually creating a business out of nothing, like seeing something that people needed and then starting a business. And if you are a woman in the 1800s, the only way you're going to have a business is if you created something that no one else was already doing, because then they would say, oh, men do that, right? So she runs a governess agency, and what she does is hire the daughters of vicars who are beautifully trained but have no money, right? And then she puts them through her own training course, which includes things like how to swim. She doesn't actually have anything to do with children. She's been widowed. So she doesn't really know too much about children, but she's got a lot of ideas about how to raise children. And as if you were the head of a governess agency, and frankly, I think we see this a lot in how to parent books. You sometimes wonder if they actually had parents, right? I have a teenager at home. I was just talking about this with a friend. I was reading something in the New York Times, and they said, I realized I had a great trouble with my teenager when he said, what the beep do you think? And he went in his room and shut the door. And I was like, that sounds like civility. He actually spoke a sentence to you. What are you complaining about? Anyway, okay, so I'm going to move on here. All right, so, oh, I went this way. All right, let's see. So if we forget that sex, its practices, the ways it's talked about, everything like that is very much germane to the moment, as a romance writer, you have to continually be accessing that again. Now, I've been married for quite a long time, so and I'm not talking about my sex life now. I'm talking about how our ideas of sex change. So if you've written as many books as I have, at some point you're like, whoa, I never wrote a governess book. I love governess books, right? I'm going to write one of those. And then this one I said, I've never had a kidnapping. I love kidnappings. I'm going to have a kidnapping. I'm writing this kidnapping. It's going really well. He's got her in his carriage. He's going to seduce her in the carriage. He has naughty children at home. He fired the first governess. The second one quit. He goes to the agency. He's like, you signed a contract. You're coming. She's like, no, I'm not. And he's like, well, actually, the carriage is headed out of London right now. You're coming. And then I thought, wait a second, what about consent? We think very differently about consent in the last 3 or 4 years, right? So now I've got a problem. I really want a kidnapping. And what's more, because I kind of run late on my books, the cover copy was written long ago, and it promises a kidnapping. It's got to be a kidnapping. But I need a moment of consent. So if you read 7 Minutes in Heaven, you're going to have probably the first historical romance in which there's a kidnapping, except he says, well, but if you really want, I'll take you back to London. And she's like, okay, fine. I agree to be kidnapped. Because I had to put consent in there. Not only because I think people would feel uneasy reading it, but because I have a lot of young readers, too. Right? I have readers of all ages. And one thing you have to be very careful about is what do you really think a 14-year-old is going to carry away from this book? People are always asking me, will your son read your books? I can tell you right now, he'd rather die, right? He's an international relations and theology double major with an Arabic minor. Like, romance is just not in his bailiwick. But I say to them, you know, if he did, let's say he did, because I actually have 16% male readership, and they are not all incarcerated, which is... But if he did, he would learn to be respectful, right? These books are about respect. My heroine, somewhat unhistorically, always use what's called a French letter or a condom, right? They are not putting themselves at risk, even though at that time they certainly knew about things like the French disease, etc., but they might not have been that cognizant of it. But my heroes always are if they're not, because I'm not really writing a historical novel. I'm writing a historical romance, and that means that I have a lot of responsibility to the younger people reading my books. I have a lot of responsibility to the healthy portion of gay young men I have reading my books, who are, you know, reading it for different reasons, but also really relishing the idea of romance and writing me. Then I have, you know, the historical readers too. So I have a lot of elderly gentlemen in Florida. If you go down to Florida, if you become a snowbird at some point in your life and you enter a home down there, you realize really fast that there's a lot of romance in the shelves. And so these guys read the romance, but, you know, they're sort of like my husband, who reads mostly history and memoir, and like, that's pretty much what he reads, I would say, that and Dante. And so they write me and they say, you know, in this ballroom scene that you set in 1801, you talked about this discovery. In fact, it happened 2 months before, but it was not reported in the London papers until 5 months afterwards. So you should have set this in April 21st. Then it would have been, you know, and I'm like, okay. Because what they're mixing up, I mean, my books are very historical, but it's not like when I wrote, I have a book of scholarship that was published with Oxford. Everything had to be correct. I would have been nailed on every single little detail. But when you're writing romance, you cannot be that accurate. If you're that accurate, you're writing a novel in which the wallpaper becomes more important than the people inside it, right? So when I'm thinking about history, I have to find something that is in history but actually sparks a plot, that becomes the plot in a way, right? Because people read my books because they want the history. We have many, many learners in this country who are sort of ignored in a way, right? We want to be learning. I think we have many lifelong learners, and one of the things they do is read memoir, biography. You know, I'm reading the Wright brothers right now. It's astonishing. We read all kinds of stuff, but even when you're reading a romance, a historical romance, you want it to be accurate. So let me give you an example. I was... 2 years ago, I ran Fordham University, my university's program in London, and I took Anna with me, obviously, and Alessandro got leave of absence. He's the chair of Italian at Rutgers. So we're all over there, and we're having a great time, except Anna is not having a great time. Because if you have any ideas about moving to a foreign country when your child is going into ninth grade, I strongly suggest you don't do it. This caused lots of problems. She went into a very tough English school, and she had purple and blue hair, and they were all exquisitely beautiful and beautifully mannered. She was never bullied or anything like that, but it was all ambassadors' children. And she had physics, chemistry, and biology, three classes at the same time all the way through the year. It was a tough year. So we're going around. I'm dragging around to museums, right? We're in a museum in Bath, and they have the table set up for this Georgian dinner, and they have a pineapple on the table. And I'm trying to interest Anna, right, who's just on her text, on her phone. I'm like, why is the pineapple there? And the docent said, because the pineapple would have been rented. Pineapples were so expensive at the time that they would go from dinner party to dinner party to dinner party. You couldn't afford a pineapple. You would rent one that maybe had seen six different dinner parties. Then you pile up a bunch of oranges and apples and you put the pineapple on the top, which is thousands of dollars worth of fruit right there, right? And then all your guests know that they are not supposed to ask the footman for a slice of the pineapple. So I'm trying to interest her. She's completely uninterested. And I'm standing there and I see an entire book, right? Because I'm American. I actually got a degree at Oxford, so I'd been there, but I've been young and malleable. I'm no longer young and malleable. So I had some real culture clashes when I was in England, seeing old friends. It was totally fun. But, you know, there are ethical points at which cultures clash and which you may not be willing to bend anymore. So I took all those experiences I'd had living that year, and I warped them around the idea of the pineapple. So I wrote a book called My American Duchess, which is about an American woman coming over. Now, in the period, pineapples were expensive in America, but not that expensive. If you had a sailor, for example, he would come back, and because they lasted a long time in the hold, there would be a lot of pineapples in the hold, you would put the pineapple on your front porch as a sign of hospitality. So if you look at a lot of American architecture, you'll see pineapples like in the porch and so on, because that's what it indicates. He's back from sea, especially, you know, on the East Coast, you get this. He's back from sea, you can come in and have a slice of pineapple, maybe, I don't know. But in England, they were way more expensive. So my American girl sits down at the table and asks for a slice of pineapple, right? And of course, the footman gives it to her. And she's kind of surprised because everyone at her end of the table quickly changes their order and is like, I would like a slice of pineapple too, right? But you can't, it became the signifier for what it meant to be American living in a strange culture. But the other thing you have to have in historic romance is wit, right? You have to be funny. That's the one thing that historical romance has. It's witty and it's accurate. So you're constantly writing that kind of book is kind of great because you're always saying, you know, when you have a fight with someone and you think of the things you should have said, well, 3 days later you say, oh, this is what she would have said, and you go back and make her more clever. And then 4 days later you think, no, she would have said this. This is even meaner. And go back and change it again. Since it takes me like a year to write a book, I have a lot of time to kind of hone my nasty conversations. So somewhere in here, I actually have a conversation. I thought I had the pineapple, but I think I left the pineapple off. I'll give you another example from the same book, though. One of the things that I use a lot is Shakespeare, obviously. Right? I know Shakespeare inside out. I teach it. It's one of the things that makes me able to write a historical novel is that I don't watch a lot of TV because I didn't have it as a kid. It's really hard to kind of go past like Top Chef, which I'm addicted to, or Project Runway, and to watch actual movies, long movies. But what I can do is read Shakespeare, which is people in the past walking and talking, right? And get it across to my class, to class after class after class of 20 and 21-year-olds. They're talking about something you know about, right? Let's talk about what Romeo was saying. Let's talk about what Juliet was saying. And so in some big ways, I end up using that. Like I probably taught for 20 years before I decided I am sick to death of Romeo and Juliet. If those guys had got married, do you know how good that marriage would have been? That would have been one really bad marriage right there. Because I don't know when you read Romeo and Juliet last, but Romeo is completely in the sky, right? He's like, I love Rosalind. Now I love Juliet. Whereas Juliet is the first woman on the English stage to propose marriage. He's sitting there going on and on and on. And she's like, if you're bent, be marriage. And he's like, what? Because he never mentioned it. He had no idea of mentioning it. And then you'd think she would say something like, send me a message, right? Text me if you want to get married. No, she's like, I'll send you a messenger tomorrow. So, I mean, Shakespeare did a brilliant job of putting total romance against total practicality. So one of the ways in which I use Shakespeare is that I learned a tremendous amount about how to shape a book. To go back again to the question of sex, Shakespeare couldn't put sex on the stage. And he definitely couldn't put kisses because most of the women's parts, I mean all the women's parts, including Juliet, was played by a boy. So unless you have a really brilliant boy, the moment when two characters kiss on stage is going to be very jarring for the audience. Because even though she's perfectly dressed, we're talking 3,000 people in the afternoon sunlight, right? So not dark, it could be in his other stage, but the main globe was lit by sunlight. So we know he had a brilliant actor at the point at which he actually engages in kissing. So with Romeo and Juliet, when he started to write that, we know that he had one of the best actors he had in his entire career. The reason for that is the ballroom scene. Okay, you remember the ballroom scene? Romeo leaps out from behind a pillar in most of the movies and sort of starts talking. So Shakespeare had them write a sonnet. So if you think about what a sonnet is really like, here's what I think about love, and here's what I think about her, and I think all about myself, right? It's me, me, me. I burn, I pine, I perish, I'm dying, I'm so in love, she's so great. Or in Shakespeare's version, my mistress's eyes are nothing like the sun, right? Her breath reeks. I mean, he was very anti that sonnet that's all about you. So he decided to write sex and put it in a play. So what he did was, now sonnet form is A, B, A, B, C, D, C, D, E, F, E, F, G, G. It's all the one speaker. So if you look at the way the sonnet goes, it'll be began by one of them, A, B, A, B, right? And then Juliet will answer, C, D, C, D. So they're matching each other. When they first meet in the ballroom, they've never met before, they start a sonnet. They cap a sonnet, right? Then in the third quatrain, they go every other one. So now they're getting to be so close that they can actually name each other's rhyme scheme, right? You go A, I'll go A. You go B, I'll go B. And then the couplet at the end, that is the closest that two people can become in the English language because you're actually rhyming their exact sentence that they just said. So their last couplet, they rhyme and they kiss. It's one of the very few kisses you have written onto the page. They then start another couplet. You remember how that ballroom scene gets cut off? The nurse comes in and says, your mother calls you. Because the second couplet is interrupted. He put the entire play into a sonnet and a half, right? They go closer and closer and they kiss. They do these things that are forbidden on the English stage. He put the sonnet, he put his whole thought. So I learned a lot from that. I learned how to create a love scene or a sex scene in which the points of view become closer and closer and closer until they're so intermingled that maybe the reader doesn't even care whose head we're in, right? Because that's what Shakespeare was doing. You just become so close that they're almost capping each other's sentences. You can't write that until the very end. So I had dinner last night with the great librarians here, and one of them asked me, do you write the sex scenes while you're writing them or at the end? The fact is, you have to write them at the end. Think about what I'm telling you. You have to know those characters so well that they can rhyme their own couplets. If they're doing that, you can rhyme their couplets because you're the one really writing it, right? So you have to be able to get them from that point of view. Now, I'm learning all this stuff about Shakespeare, right? I'm learning a lot about the way he constructed plays. I also learned a lot about how to cover up things that you don't want to have noticed. Does anyone know that Othello is completely impossible? Could not happen that way. There's a huge time problem in Othello. You know Othello, right? Desdemona supposedly slept with someone a million times, and so Othello kills her. But the fact is, she just lost her virginity a day and a half before. There's a big problem. But I learned by looking at that how you pull one thing forward and you drop the other things back, and by far the majority of your readers won't notice that you found you had a problem. The 1% will write you a long letter, very long letter, point out what you did, but I let that go. Anyway, so I use Shakespeare a lot, but you know, my readers don't know Shakespeare, right? I'm not writing lectures here. I'm not gonna give you guys a quiz at the end. I certainly don't want my books to read as if there's a quiz. At the same time, I teach it all every day, so I wanna make fun of it. So I'm gonna give you an example. Again, because I had the American coming in, meeting British society, I used Shakespeare as another lever, like the pineapple. So this is a very, very rude young lady. Shakespeare's immortal words run through the veins of every English subject, even more in my case. Since those plays were written by one of my relatives, everyone knows the Earl of Essex was the real author of the plays. If any of you are going to be Shakespearean, you'll spend the rest of your life at cocktail parties saying, who really wrote Shakespeare? So I wrote that for my own pleasure. Wait, what happened to the next page of it? So it disappeared. Darn, I don't want to do it by hand. I don't want to make it up because I will do it wrong. Let me see. Oh, here it is. Okay. So, Lady Caroline. Oh, this is Mary, okay? So Mary is M-E-R-R-Y. She's written Mary because Christmas was banned in the colonies when her mother was an English woman who came over, and so she's named after Merry Christmas. So it's one of those things, again, where you try to get these little historical details in there. At some point she explains it, and someone will carry it away with them and like it, the teacher side of me. Okay, we Americans are woefully ignorant. All I remember is that my governess said that Shakespeare was a Glover's son, and wasn't there something about how his father was fined for having a dunghill in front of his house, which he was, by the way. Lady Caroline sighed gustily. Really, Miss Pelford, I must ask you to refrain from talk of dunghills. I gather all sorts of vulgarity are acceptable in the colonies, but not here. So Mary thinks, you know, the colonies, the war's been over for like over 20 years. But when I was reading, when I'm reading diaries and letters from the period, they kept referring to them as colonies long after we had declared our independence. During his lifetime, everyone in London knew the Shakespeare, the Duke said. They saw him writing in pubs and they talked about him. Lady Caroline, who wants to marry this Duke, was clearly torn between offending an eligible Duke and burnishing her claim to Bardian blood. Nature prevailed over policy. No man of low bud could have written such immortal lines, she pronounced. Well, you might as well say he was, she stopped. That he was American, Mary suggested. She tapped her finger, chin with her finger. Why didn't I think of that? Perhaps I too am descended from the bard. Because I want to bring Shakespeare in, and I don't want to have him in there as an information dump, right? If you like Shakespeare, I want you to enjoy it. If you don't know anything about Shakespeare, I want you to carry away from the fact that he had a big pile of poo in front of his front door when he was growing up. But I can't, I have to make everything part of the plot. So you see a lot about Mary, about this other, and even about the Duke. So here, I found the pineapple section. So they eat the pineapple, they go into the drawing room, the ladies retire to drawing room, and Mary instantly realizes she's done something terribly wrong, right? Because she's eaten fruit that was worth thousands of dollars. Luckily, she's an heiress and they have a lot of money, but that in itself is considered vulgar. So my heiress, my hostess, was called Mrs. Bennet. So if you know Pride and Prejudice, I was playing on that for real. I would never buy a pineapple, Mrs. Bennet replied airily. Their appearance pleases me, hence I rent one to create my table's centerpiece, but most people I know can't abide the flavor. At that, the ladies all fell over themselves to assure that they too loathed pineapple and had only accepted a slice from politeness. Rent, so you're in Mary's head, right? The pineapple had been rented. Who rents food? What next, Lady Caroline said, laughing. Will the guests begin to swill the violets in the finger bowls? Because, you know, they used to have those little violets. Who would have dreamed that a hostess could rent a pineapple for a dinner party? Yet Londoners did, apparently, and had been profoundly gauche of Mary to request a slice. Embarrassment flooded through her, spreading right to the tips of her fingers. I was not aware that the pineapple was merely a decoration, she said apologetically. We do eat them at home. In fact, Mr. Kestrel told me that King Charles II enjoyed the very first pineapple grown in England back in 1675. That's my professor's side taking over. But it's just one line, right? Lady Caroline turned her shoulder and whispered loudly to the hostess, one cannot expect persons from the colonies to understand civilized behavior. I declare, said Mrs. Bennet, I would be terrified to travel into the wilderness where no rules of polite society pertain. Why, I wouldn't be surprised to find a naked savage serving the dinner instead of a table in livery. I shouldn't have the faintest idea how to conduct myself, as indeed is clearly the case for those who travel from those shores. All thoughts of further apology flew from Mary's head. She leaned forward and smiled at their hostess. I do assure you, Mrs. Bennet, that were you to visit my country, you would find our customs easy to negotiate. For example, in America, you won't find a single stalk of asparagus on the table unless your hostess wishes you to eat it, and unless that hostess owns the asparagus. She gets back. Because that's the great thing about writing, right? You can get back. A lot of the things that happen in that book actually get drawn out of dinner parties, because, you know, at this point, I'm published in 26 countries, right? So I'm lucky enough to have fans around, well, in 26 countries around the world. So one of the things that happened was I got invited to a lot of really wonderful meals, including one at the House of Lords, which was fascinating, right? It was actually hereditary lord, took us to dinner, and, you know, it was fun for a lot of reasons. I bought a new outfit. I went to the store where Kate buys her clothes. So I was like, I'm going to look like everyone else in there. In fact, a lot of them looked like they kind of rolled out of bed, sort of, in their suit. But it was fascinating because what you can do in a book is not what you can do in real life, right? So, like, I went to Oxford. I was at a high table. I had been at King's College when I was there, but I went to a different high table, and they told me a story about the mango on the table, that they'd had a mango on the table, and the mango was always on the table. And a visiting woman from Canada, I have to say, when I went to high table, I was the only woman at the high table, because Oxford is nothing if not retrograde. And so a woman had come from Canada, a professor, and she said, may I have a slice of the mango? Because you are being served constantly on a pedestal. Think Harry Potter, right? In your gowns. And the old gentleman across from her said, she's asked for a slice of the mango. So apparently they had not known how to eat it. So it had just sat there, renewed. So of course I put that right into the book, because you have to. All right, how am I doing on time? Let me just see. Oh, okay, I've got to quit. Hold on. I'm going to tell you just one more letter. I'm going to end with one letter, because it's not easy being a writer these days. When I started, I would get like 5 letters a year. They all came in one envelope. They were forwarded by my publisher. And one of them was from a lovely woman in Canada who would summarize the plot of my novels. She never said anything critical, but she would tell me everything that happened on yellow paper and send it to me. So I got kind of used to her. She's still writing me. She has now transferred onto onto actual computer. I still get a certain amount of letters, like I'm hearing from my 5th grade teacher quite often, and she writes actual physical letters. She claims all rights to my books. It's all her, which is great. I don't remember who she is, so I'm all about it. But you get letters all the time, right? And if you think about that, we authors are now an author platform. We exist on social media. I have 100,000 people following me on Facebook, 20,000 on Twitter. I don't know how many thousand on Instagram, which is, on Litzy, which is my favorite social media. If you're a book person, you have to join Litzy. It's like totally fun. It's just about books and no one owns it. So there's no advertising. But you're constantly, like at one point my Twitter password stopped working. And I thought, well, this is a sign from God, right? I'm done with this. 2 days later, there's HarperCollins. Dear Eloisa, we noticed something seems to have happened to your account. We contacted Twitter. Here's your new password. And you're just like, because you're the lead author, right? So it's not, I could stand up here and bitch about it all day, but the fact is, there's a big publishing apparatus and a lot of people depending on you getting the book in on time, right? Writing your readers back, because a reader who is replied to is like 50,000 more times likely to buy the next book, even if she didn't like that one. She wrote you to say she didn't like it. You wrote back and said, I'm really sorry you didn't like this part, right? If she writes a vicious letter, I don't write back. But most people don't. They write very polite letters just saying, this really disappointed me. And I wish next time that your hero would not do X, Y, and Z. I'll give you an example. I had a book called The Ugly Duchess. And I was really writing, it's based on The Ugly Duckling, so I was writing about concepts of beauty. I wanted the hero to be incredibly beautiful in Regency England, and the heroine to be considered ugly. And I based her on a supermodel from now, who we all think is incredibly beautiful. In fact, we pay millions of dollars to even see her, right? So I wanted to reverse it. By the end, he is ugly because he's got a tattoo now, which of course we would consider him incredibly beautiful. And his voice has been damaged, so he could now sing like Leonard Cohen, which is, I love. So he had turned into the ugly one and she had become the beautiful one. Well, this necessitated they had to grow up because they got married at 18. They had 1.5 days together and it was over. And he leaves, she kicks him out. She's like, goodbye forever. And he leaves, and the first version I wrote, they were apart for 7 years before he decides to go back, and he didn't have sex during that time. And then I'm thinking, this is ridiculous, right? He left the country, he's not planning to come back. He would not have been faithful all that time. He actually changed his name. He would have slept with someone. So I wrote like a paragraph in which he has one mistress, and then like there's the mention of another one. Also because their sex didn't go so well, and I was hoping that when he came back to England, they could, like, I wouldn't have to get into it. Because bad sex can be a really fun thing to write, and you get a lot of very sad letters from women saying, that's exactly what my sex love. You're like, ugh. But you have to spend all this time solving it then, which is not what I wanted to be doing. So I have this one little paragraph where he's adulterous. Then he decides to go back home and, I can't tell you how many letters I got saying, your hero was adulterous. You've never had an adulterous hero before. I would never read you again. And I wrote each one of them back because maybe I should have stuck with it. My editor was like, he shouldn't be adulterous. And I thought, I got to have some reality in here. Maybe I shouldn't have the reality because I'm not writing in the genre of reality, you know? So we make missteps and we learn from the readers. But if you don't write them back to say, hey, you know, I'm thinking maybe you were right, or here's why you're not right and here's why I did it, you get a conversation going. I totally believe in that, but I've got to say it can be exhausting. My father got a lot of mail too. You know, when they weren't hitchhiking, they used to write letters. And he had a bathtub in his study, was like a little house, and he would throw them in the bathtub. And I, always trying to make money. I mean, I seem very, very mercantile looking back, but I was always trying to make money so I could buy books, really. I would go out there and work as a secretary. So I would randomly pick letters out of the bathtub, and they were almost always young poets. And they would send along a poem. And so over the years, because now I'm on, you know, I have a Wikipedia page or whatever, I'm getting sent these letters because everyone kept them. They said things like, I am Mary Bly. I am Robert Bly's daughter. I'm 9 years old. My father says you should get a job. But I like the poem. I thought the dog is really nice. Yours sincerely, Mary Bly. These poets all kept them. And some of them, believe it or not, are very famous now. So they're like, he was wrong. But my dad would say whatever, and I would just type the whole thing up and send it off. So I also have this sense that I've been on the other side. So I'm going to end by reading you a letter. It's my favorite fan letter ever. Dear Ms. Eloisa James, I was looking for information about Egypt on the internet. I typed E into the Google search box, and I ended up at your website. Wow, what a layout, what accomplishments, what promotions, what superlatives, what testimonials, what a life. At first, I thought this person must be an actor on TV or Hollywood or Broadway, maybe. How do you rate all this stuff? Frankly, I think it's overdone. Is it all that necessary to sell books? Well, come to think of it, there is another writer who has a similar website, Nicholas Sparks. There's no humility in either of you. So I'm like, you know, Nicholas Sparks is not the end of the world, right? I'll take Nicholas Sparks. So I do write them all back, but sometimes you don't write them back. Sometimes a letter is just a clear call for revenge. Dear Bob, thank you very much for contracting ElouisaJames.com. You are now added to Eloisa's email list and will be receiving daily, if not hourly, updates on her many accomplishments. She will personally inform you of each new degree she receives. We have automatically Googled you and obtained your home address and entered you into a sweepstakes to win a lover's trip to San Domingo in the Love Boat. If you win, Eloisa will pay for the Chippendale dancers to come to Akron, Ohio and dance for you. Thank you so, so much for your kind words and support of Eloisa's accomplishments and books. It's fans like you, says Eloisa, who make her what she is. Hugs, Eloisa. Here's the thing. I got the most lovely apology. It was great. So I just want to end there and say, if you write me someday, I will write you back. I will not even write like that. I'll write you a real letter back. So we're going to have question and answer now. Everything's very planned. So we're going to have question and answer. But I wanted to say one thing first, which is that we're going to have a book signing at the end. And often, I'm in libraries. Like, libraries are flying me around. And this costs a lot of money for a library to fly me out here, right? This is not paid for by HarperCollins. It's actually paid for you all with your real estate taxes, I believe. However, HarperCollins donated these books. So if you buy a book, I have wonderful historical recipe cards. I'm going to give you a whole set, right? And they're like the books that are mentioned in here, because my heroine is also a baker. So I have like Hannah Glass's Trifle from 1794. Now, when you get that card, on the other side is Nigella Lawson's Trifle, because Hannah, bless her heart, that trifle doesn't work. But Nigella's I've made many times, and it's fantastic. The rest of them are all... they're all just the recipe. So this is my gift to the people who put on these events. So if you buy a book, you get a set of those recipe cards wrapped up in a very beautiful ribbon. If you buy three, you get three sets. So please buy one for your aunt, buy one for your daughter. They make fabulous Christmas presents. And that's my plea, to keep this library going. Let's get some of that money back into their coffers. Let's support this kind of event. I know this library is starting an events. I was going to start a bigger event series right now from what I was hearing, and I think that's a fantastic thing. It's great for community. So Please ask me some questions, or I'll call on you. Yes. I haven't, mostly because when I started writing, Regency was what was selling. And so I started in the Regency, and then I moved to the Georgian period, which is where my next series is going to be. The Georgian series is, you know, think Regency is Jane Austen, Georgian is Marie Antoinette, so totally fun. But I know too much about the Elizabethan period. Like, it would be very hard for me to kind of gloss over things. One of the big things I deal with, for example, is death and childbirth. I always have an epilogue in which my hero and heroine have children and are alive, because, you know, 50% of them would have died in childbirth. That would have been even higher in the Elizabethan period. So I can kind of fudge things. Like, I often have somebody come back who, miracle of miracles, heard that you should wash your hands if you're in childbirth, that sort of thing. But the scholar would then clash with the writer in me, if that makes sense. Yes?
Thank you so much. Okay. I do have a gripe. Now, of course, I have to go back, and you put the footnotes and said where Eugenia and Ward or Teddy had been in a previous
yes.
book as children. So now, of course, I have to go back and reread that book because I can't remember all your characters
yeah.
from it. Are you going to continue to do that? Or, you know, what makes you sort of retain these characters and then put them in new mm-hmm. books?
Well, I have to say, in that one, see, I'd written 6 books set in the Georgian period, and I had a key character in there called the Duke of Villiers, who had all these children, illegitimate children, and I love him. If you look at that actual series of 6, he acts as a slight Cupid character in each one of the 6, and his children were so vivid to me that I wanted to bring them back. I work very much by patterning my books, so you may not notice the structure. But in there, for example, all 3 of these books, 3 Weeks with Lady X, 4 Nights with the Duke, and 7 Minutes in Heaven, are all patterned because they all have illegitimate sort of characters in them. All 3 heroines are entrepreneurs who started a business. You know, they all have letters, exchanges of clever letters between the hero and heroine. I try to make as many, to bind them together as many ways as possible. It's another way of talking about it is I try to make the books accessible on lots of different levels. So if you hadn't read those books, it doesn't matter to you. If you had read those books, it's kind of a pleasurable little thing you notice, right? There's it seems to have become everyone's favorite line in there is when the hero's asking the heroine about what it's like to get out of mourning, to get out of mourning clothes, right? And she says, well, you know, first you wear black and then you switch to gray. And he's like, gray? Like what? And she's like, there's many shades of gray. He's like, and she says, oh, there's probably 50 shades of gray. I've had like 9 million letters about that. But that's an example where I put in a pop culture thing. So to give you another example, I wrote a book called When Beauty Tamed the Beast. And that is obviously a version of Beauty and the Beast, right? On one level. Because if you're a romance writer, the more like structure you can give yourself to fight against, the more original the book will be. So you've got the romance, you know it has to end easily. It has to end happily. That's one structure. Now I've got Beauty and the Beast inside that structure. Now I decide to base the Beast on House MD. Have you all seen that show? So I've got a doctor, I've got an epidemic, I've got all these things, and I read 7 years of scripts of House MD. I got his clever language down because the scriptwriters for House MD are brilliant. So now I have another layer of sort of conscription within there. I decide it's not enough. If you happen to be an English scholar or you remember your high school English, that book is also shaped around the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock, the poem by T.S. Eliot. So you'll see the women talking of Michelangelo come and go, and the question of drowning comes and goes through it. So just the way Shakespeare did, he was writing for, you know, people in the boxes and then the apprentices, so parts in Latin and then parts that are just dirty jokes. I try to write each book on those different levels. So if you've read it, you enjoy it. If you've read Prufrock, you enjoy this. If you are a huge fan of Beauty and the Beast, by the way, they're bringing the book out again with a yellow dress on the cover to match the movie, you enjoy it. So see what I mean? I just try to splice it all up to appeal to lots of people.
So that's my favorite book, and it's deliciously tragic. But do you find your Shakespearean professor side pushing that tragedy, those tragic moments into your literature, your novels, from what you've learned and what you're teaching your students in order to get a more successful happily ever after?
Well, when you talk, I mean, it's not tragedy, right? Because no one really dies. No.
It feels tragic.
Yes, feels tragic. I have to say, if you're a writer, if you find yourself weeping as you write, think, you know, Romancing the Stone, and she's sitting there like crying. If you find yourself in there crying, it's like ka-ching. It's the New York Times right there, right? You're going to the top 10 because it's your emotion that drives it. So that story I told you about Midnight Pleasures, when I put all my fear of losing a child into that book, it's your emotion that drives it. And I was crying hysterically writing that scene. I never again caused a child to be born because I was so freaked out by the fact that I then had a child born prematurely. I felt as if I wrote my own life somehow. Of course, by the way, she's a very fractious teenager, absolutely fine, you know, failing economics, but that's her problem. But I think what you're talking about is just huge bursts of emotion, right? It depends on how you're feeling. Like if you look at 7 Minutes in Heaven, it's a very funny book. And I didn't feel like having a big dark hole that everyone falls into and has to climb out of. Because lately I felt like the kind of escape I want to laugh, I want to learn a little history. You know, I don't want big explosive darkness. But at various points in my career, I felt like that. And I probably will again. You have to go with what you feel like. You have to do. And then some people write me and say, that's my absolute favorite book. And people write and say, that's the only book I hate. Because it made me cry. I hate to cry. Like, you know, or I love to cry. So. You never know, right? Lizzie and Otis are the children in this book. So in terms of what you write next, in terms of my own life, I'll tell you right now, like Otis in here has a pet rat named Jarvis who has opera cloaks sewn out of velvet. That comes right out of my own life. My daughter has Teddy, Peter, and Gus who have cloaks, super rat cloaks, knitted by my sister in Ann Arbor. So they each have their own cloak for Halloween. You take your own life and put it in. And so it would depend on a moment when Lizzie, for example, particularly is a very interesting kid, that I would want to grow her forward. But because of when she is, I would have to grow her forward to the Victorian period, which I don't know much about. So it would be an undertaking. That doesn't mean I won't. But right now I'm backing up into the Georgian period for the next book. And I have a great series I'm really excited about. The next book is called Wild in Love. And Georgian period is Marie Antoinette, right? But it's the beginning of the age of celebrity. So you're always looking for ways to tie what's happening now into what's happening then, because that's what makes a book sing. That's what makes it interesting. And so in that period, you have the first real celebrity because they can, for the first time, do cheap mechanical reproductions of etchings, right? So my hero is an explorer, and he's been going out. His name is Lord Alaric Wilde. His books are published as Lord Wilde. So he wrote like Wild Sargasso Sea and Wild Latitudes when he was running around with the pirates. But, you know, like 25 people read his books, 15 of whom are his relatives. So he doesn't really care. He's a son of a duke. You know, he's doing it for pleasure. And he also makes a lot of money, but he's sailing back to London after 5 years at sea, and they come up on the dock, and as far as you can see, there are women, just women. And the captain's like, what the heck is going on? And they decide that they must have made a mistake in the lists, because they published the list in the paper of who's sailing in on what ship. Must have made a mistake and put a prince in there. But no, during the 5 years he's been gone, these etchings have gone out all over England in the tinker's carts. And everyone from the Duchess to the chambermaid is collecting etchings of him wrestling an octopus, right? Climbing a mountain. He's never climbed a mountain. Doesn't matter. He's climbing a mountain, putting the British flag on top of an Arctic mountain. He's never even been to the Arctic. And he's caught in this celebrity trap, which was really interesting for me to write about and really fun, and I think we'll create, you know, we see that. So these guys are not Lizzie and Otis, sorry, but I have created a huge ramshackle Duke's family that lives on the edge of a bog in Cheshire, the bog called Lindell Moss, which is where the Lindell Moss man was found, if you know, and it's going to be no ballrooms, but lots and lots of fun.
Three quick questions about your process. Are you a pantser or a plotter? It's like you're writing a series. How do you keep track of all the details? Do you have a big notebook? Do you keep it in your head, index cards? And how do you name your characters?
Okay, I'm going to start with the most recent one. The letter. I name my characters. I change them constantly. I have a bunch of books that if you're a historical writer, the most useful thing you can do is go online to the nobility thing, so they're all on Google Books. And sometimes I'll just say, oh, I really need somebody whose last name starts with a G, and I'll go there to the list of nobility, and I'll just look through the G's till I find a really good name, and I'll change it a little bit. You do want to be careful not to put a first and a last name in, because, for example, I often pull them out of the indexes of scholarly books that I'm reading for something to do with Shakespeare, because, you know, I'm going to give a paper at the Shakespeare Association. So I had a book about the East India Company, which is Renaissance, and I pulled somebody out of the back of it, and I had him kidnap a prince. That was a big mistake, because, yeah, his relatives are still around in England. They were deeply offended that I would have portrayed this worthy, worthy man as a kidnapper of a prince. So I learned from that. I try to change it up a little bit. But names are really, really important. First names are tremendously important. To give you an example, Ward, who's the hero of this book, was Teddy when he was 8 years old, who peed in people's beds and sucked his thumb. And I was like, no, I really want to grow him up. But I have to make a huge distinction between the people who knew him as Teddy. There has to be this huge thing. And he can't be called Teddy. And he can't be called Edward, because that didn't fit his personality. So I end up with Ward, which sounds a little bit to me like an MC cop romance, you know. But it's the best I could do. So names are really important. Okay, what was number two? I don't even remember what number two. I often know one scene that I'm heading for, and I just kind of let that dictate the whole novel. So I'll give you an example. In Your Wicked Ways, the hero and heroine had been married very young, and they were completely estranged, right? And the hero is actually living with an opera singer. And I base this, again, a lot of it comes out of my real life. You know, I feel like I'm Simon and Garfunkel, who grew up in the Bach family. You know, my dad won the American Book Award for poetry. I won the Rita Award for Seduced by a Pirate. Right? We're kind of in different realms, as it were. And so she is based on Clara Schumann, who was a wonderful, wonderful musician, classical musician at the time. And he's based on basically Simon and Garfunkel, or, you know, he's writing musical comedy, and it doesn't work as a marriage. After like 2 weeks, it's over. So this is many years later, and she wants to have a baby. And she's desperate to have a baby. I had a lot of friends going through IVF. So you spend a lot of them and go, okay, what would my heroine do? Would she go as far as this friend of mine who's taking these very invidious hormones? Yes, she definitely would. So she marches up and she's like, sorry, by the way, I'm going to get pregnant. I just thought you'd like to know, because of course that will be his heir. And he's like, no, you're not. You know, if you're having a child, it's going to be my child. She's like, I'm fine with that. Because you don't care whose child it is, you just want the baby. And he says, well, the only way you're getting is you move in. And she says, I'm not moving in. You're living with an opera singer. And he says, there's an extra room. Because that all goes back to my question, right? How far would you go to have a baby? And you got to push that question as far as you can. And I thought, you know, she would move in. My friend who was going through IVF, she'd be in that house. So she moves into the house. This is the only scene I knew when I started the book, was they're sitting opposite each other at the dining room table, and the heroine says, I'm going to borrow him tonight, if you don't mind. If I remember correctly, it's only a matter of 10 minutes, 5 minutes. And the opera singer looks at him and says, on a good night, 10. You see what a challenge I've set myself? Like, it's insane, right? It's terrible in bed and everything else. In case you're wondering, he and the opera singer weren't sleeping together, but it worked really well. So sometimes I only have that one scene. The problem with being a planner, which I've tried several times to do, is that I end up changing it so much. I change everything. I unfortunately have to delete about 100 to 170 books per book, pages per book, because genre fiction lives or dies on its pacing. And you have to write yourself into the character often. So I have wonderful pages, like fantastic scenes. They're loving, they're romantic, they're interesting, they're witty conversations, and they're gone. So Wild in Love, which comes out in November, at the moment, my editor and I are taking a little break from each other because she has read it for the fourth time and suggested that page 20 to 53 need to go. And I've already cut like 150 pages out of it. So we decided we would take a break. Now, we still email several times a day, but we're not discussing that book because it's hard. It's really hard to make the sacrifices that have to be made. Okay, was there a third one? Or did I
just wondered how you keep track of it.
Oh, I don't. It's very bad. When you read 7 Minutes in Heaven, you'll see a little note in the historic thing that says, I brought somebody back from the dead, yay me. Because I had a crazy character in a previous book, and I was trying to figure out in this book why she would be so crazy, right? And I thought, well, obviously it's her mother. But unfortunately, in the earlier book, I had a mention of her mother as having died, whereas in this book, her mother is live and running around being really awful. So I should make that big notebook, right? Yeah. Yes.
What's the hardest scene you've ever written?
Well, you'd think it would be something, deep in emotion. Those are not the hardest scenes. The hardest scenes are the beginnings, because you have to ditch them over and over and over until you get the right thing, right? Beginnings can be incredibly hard, like where does the book start? And I had no idea with my first book. I wrote it, I wanted to pay off my student loans. So I wrote this book and I based it on the life of the Earl of Essex, which was one of my orals topics at Yale for my PhD. And I remember going in and my dad, it was very embarrassing, my dad was in New York and he for years was published by HarperCollins. And so he comes in and he asks my editor, who I've only met once, so humiliating. She was like, why did you want to buy her book? He was very proud of me. He is still. I mean, he's got dementia, but he's very proud. And she said, oh, it's the opening page. I read the opening page and knew I was going to buy it. And I was like, why? And she said, no. It was the first line. And that was my first introduction to just how important the first line is. And I'd written this thing without a second thought. You know, it was something like Charlotte's life fell in half like the two halves of a gaily colored child's ball. Something like that. I haven't got it right. But I mean, that line got me published in hardcover. So always I go back to the first page over and over. It's the thing that makes people decide whether to buy it now because of the Kindle downloads, the iTunes downloads. I mean, really, you don't get past the first page, you just delete that sample instantly. So,
I am also an English professor. And in several of my classes, I either teach romance or teach about things connected to romance. So, for example, I'm teaching a women in literacy class right now, and this week we talked about the community surrounding romance writers and fan communities and interactions between authors and their readers. Mm-hmm. But my students typically come in very, and I should add, these are cross-listed with women's studies, so these are almost all female students, all of whom, like myself, identify as feminists. Mm-hmm. They come in with very negative attitudes towards romance. And when I start talking with them about, okay, well, let's look back at the history of treatment of female writers and Hawthorne's damned mob of scribbling women, attitudes towards genre fiction in general, but specifically genre fiction written by women. Mm-hmm. And isn't it pretty feminist to think that women's sex is important and sexual pleasure is important, and when women's experiences are at the center of a book, isn't that pretty important? They start to change their minds a little bit.
Right.
But where I'm going out with this is I'm wondering how you, I know again, you're a Shakespearean scholar, so I'm not sure how often you're talking about romance at all with your students in particular, but I'm wondering how you confront some of these issues, particularly this idea that somehow these books are unworthy because they are sexual. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the teaching moments, I've been working with college students for now about 20 years, one of the moments that most sticks with me is when I had a student, female, feminist, women's studies major, say that she felt guilty about reading a Jennifer Cruzy novel because she was afraid that people would think she was smutty. Mm-hmm. And that was just shocking to me, that like, you are so sex positive in every other area of your life, but you can't enjoy this.
We take in a lot of that, right? We absorb a lot of the cultural hatred of the idea that women would, it's a real fear, right? There's a book that people read to arouse themselves, which is such a reductive way of even talking about a romance, because, I mean, the sex is a very small part of it with most of them. I mean, I'm not talking about something like 50 Shades of Grey, which really is an erotic novel, and not the kind of thing I read. But I think it's really hard how much young women in particular absorb the sort of hatred or the fear of women's sexuality that is in our culture. Right, you can see it in all kinds of things. In Girls, for example, you know that TV show. There's a lot of portrayals of women that basically, you know, if you're having sex, you should fall under a train. I mean, not that much stuff has changed in some ways. In other ways, though, basically, feminist scholars are looking at romance as the most feminist genre of all, because it is the genre in which the woman wins always, right? Absolutely wins. So There's another way, because so many women read romance, right? And because romance in itself is so women powerful. It's the books that are given out, for example, in domestic abuse shelters. It's given to people with PTSD. It's given to lots of people. I have lots and lots and lots of readers who are military people abroad who do not want to be triggered by anything. They're having a hard time keeping an even keel as it is, or they return to the U.S. and a really hard time with PTSD. These are books in which the woman succeeds and the woman does not die, right? And so from my point of view, they are the most feminist genre. I will say that I've definitely encountered some of that. What's happened as I got more, you know, basically as I got more famous, is that I now have a certain segment of my class, they come in, they're like, well, I'm an electrical engineer, but my mom said she won't pay my tuition unless I take your class. So I'm like, all right, I'm not signing your book for Christmas until you turn in your final paper, right? No Christmas books are going to be signed. And then I have to say, you know, you're dealing with Professor Bly right here. Do you realize how many people I fail? I'm a really tough grader. Do you realize that I'm going to quiz you? And pretty much they kind of get with the program. But there's occasional glitches. I mean, I had one young man write me an email, and he said, why should I care about the grade from someone who writes soft porn? Yeah, well, that went straight to his dean. And you know what? He had asked me for a recommendation. I was like, guess what? I'm not giving you the recommendation. He was like, well, you don't have to be so sensitive. Because they don't really understand the power of words a lot. So, you know, the young women who are like, I can't do that because it'll make me look lesser. I say to them, you know, who are you looking greater for, right? Who's judging you, and why do you give a damn what they're judging you about? Now, I have to say, it took me a while to come to a point where I was comfortable having Eloisa have any place in the classroom. It was really only when I'm one of the few professors at Fordham who likes teaching freshmen, so I'll teach freshmen in their first semester. I teach freshman comp. And Fordham is extremely diverse. We have 88% of people on financial aid. And in one classroom, you're going to have a kid who went to Swiss boarding school and somebody from the Bronx who's, you know, not illiterate by any means, but I mean, we're emphasizing diversity. And so I teach that class very much as like, what are you getting out of coming here, right? We splice advertisements. We come up with arguments. We teach you how to write a sentence that you can argue with in any job you have, because the kids graduating now are going to have 6 jobs, but they have to be able to write in every single one of them, and, you know. So I try there to set the basis of, I have 2 careers. You can have 2 careers, right? You can be a reader, you can be a writer, and you can be an electrical engineer. You don't have to be only one thing. You don't have to do this till 10 o'clock at night. You can be doing 2 things. And I think that's helpful. I have a bunch of my students who are writers. Yay. They're all, you know, none of them are writing romance, alas. But, well, no, I take that back. One graduate student is writing romance, has a very serious career writing motorcycle club books. She, too, is a professor now. But augmenting her pitiful professor's career by writing MC novels. Okay, do we have maybe one more question? My voice is starting to go, yeah. We don't become what we read about, you know? I mean, I hear you in terms of the sort of the lack of validity of that particular dream. Now, I didn't read 50 Shades of Grey. It's just not my kind of thing. But obviously, I spent a lot of time thinking about it. We all did. And if you ask me, a lot of these things you figure out 10 years later, in the same way I was telling you about bodice rippers changing. If we look 10 years ahead from 50 Shades of Grey, in my opinion, that's going to have to do with economics. So one-third of the households in this country are headed by women, right? Another fourth, the woman is making considerably more money than her partner. And I think 50 Shades of Grey asks the question, how far would you go for a guy who's actually going to buy you a car that works, right, who's got money? And I think some of that, it's hard to be a 17-year-old girl right now. It's hard to be, you know, a virgin and be facing the various pressures. It would be nice to have some of this taken care of. And I think romance is one of the places that we back into maybe some of our wishes. It doesn't mean, though, that we go out and find a 35-year-old guy with a lot of money. I mean, maybe some people do, but my guess is their mothers would have trained them to do that. You know, that's sort of that's something you learn at your mom's knee if you're going to be that. But I do know a lot of people who just back into books as a way of taking care of the incredible pressures that are going on. It's not really TMI, but my daughter is in a group therapy for children with serious medical issues, and she's fine. She just has chronic kidney disease. But the other kids in there have real problems, you know, heart valve transplant, complete liver failure. So we're talking sort of the fault in our stars, right? And she's the only one who hasn't had a relationship, a serious relationship. So she comes home and tears her hair. She's like, I'm a failure. And they come home and think, I'm a failure because I'm going to die. And she's like, I'm a failure because I haven't had sex. And I just think these people are facing so much pressure right now, right? Let's say you only have this amount of time, which thank God Anna has all the time in the world. Some of them don't. So you see the pressures coming on these kids to make decisions that may not be the best ones. But Anna backs up, and you know what she's reading right now? The Flowers from the Attic series. She's read them all. And she's got them in audio, too. It's just so distressing. And those of you who don't know it, it's all about incest. And that does not mean that she is going to go do something untoward in that area. But boy, is she escaping from any possibilities in her current life by looking at stuff that's just not even a possibility, you know? If she's not reading that, she's reading dystopia. Again, I'm not Cope. I'm not reading teenage romance. I'm not reading any of that. I'm not reading Fault in Our Stars. I'm reading, you know, the world has been destroyed and one girl survives. Because I think I would say that those books are responding to anxiety. And my guess is those are read by quite young girls. Now, I will say that I got very anxious about a month ago about something, and I found myself just downloading Harlequin Presents chic books. I used to read them in high school. They're still writing them. I read like 30 in 1 week. And they're all about chics, if you think. And this has obviously got nothing to do with the situation that my son is studying in international relations with his Arabic minor. These are all like small Arab countries, and the guy was always educated in Oxford, blah, blah, blah. Who knows what the impulse is to escape into that, but it definitely does not mean that, you know, there's any reality in it for any of the women reading it. It's some kind of escapism. Okay, there was one more question here. So, yes.
You actually just answered my question, but I wanted to thank you for coming to Fort Wayne.
Oh, you're welcome. My pleasure. Thank you. I have to say, I really like Fort Wayne. I went out with my children's godfather for 10 years, was from Fort Wayne, and part of his family's right down here, which is so nice to see you. And so I used to come. I came my freshman year, and I've been to Fort Wayne a lot, and I don't think it's changed a lot. From what I saw, it's looking the same. So thank you. Thank you very much for coming. And now we have the reception and whatever, so come up and ask me anything you want.